Good evening, and thank you for coming out on this fantastic night to our opening show for the 2015 season, the Miami City Ballet's Heatscape. We're thrilled to be... we're thrilled to be featuring Justin Peck again and to be welcoming back Miami City Ballet, and this evening to introduce Shepard Fairey, the artist who designed the whole program. The show is going to premiere on March the 27th in Palm Beach, where we all wish we were today. And you will get a chance to meet the wonderful moderator, the fantastic panel, the fabulous dancers, and even the brilliant pianist at the reception afterwards, which will be on these two lobbies because we're installing something upstairs right now. So without further ado, Heatscape.
Hi everyone, thanks for joining us tonight to preview and talk about Heatscape. My name is Ellen Barr. I am a former soloist with New York City Ballet and now the Director of Media Projects for New York City Ballet. I'll be your moderator. On our panel we have Lourdes Lopez. Lourdes danced as a soloist and principal with New York City Ballet for 24 years, working with the two legends, George Balanchine and Jerome Robbins. After retiring, Lourdes joined WNBC-TV in New York as a cultural arts reporter, writing and producing feature segments on the arts. In 2002, Lourdes became the executive director of the George Balanchine Foundation. In 2007, she co-founded Morphosis with Christopher Wheeldon. She was the first artist ever elected to serve on the Ford Foundation's Board of Trustees. And in 2012, Lourdes became artistic director of Miami City Ballet. Justin Peck is only 27 years old, but he's already been hailed as a very important voice in 21st century choreography. He is currently a soloist dancer with New York City Ballet. Since his debut as a choreographer in 2009, he's created works for New York City Ballet, LA Dance Project, Pacific Northwest Ballet, the Guggenheim Museum, and more. In 2014, Justin realized a long-term dream. He was appointed resident choreographer of New York City Ballet. He's only the second person to ever hold that position at that institution. And Shepard Fairey, who designed the backdrop for Heatscape. Shepard Fairey is from Charleston, South Carolina. He received his Bachelor of Fine Arts in Illustration at the Rhode Island School of Design. While at RISD, he created the Andre the Giant Has a Posse sticker that transformed into the Obey Giant art campaign. His work has evolved into an acclaimed body of art, which includes the 2008 Hope portrait of Barack Obama, which I'm sure you've all seen. In addition to his guerrilla street art presence, Shepard has executed more than 42 large-scale painted public murals all over the world. His works are in the permanent collections of the MoMA, the Victoria and Albert Museum, the Smithsonian's National Portrait Gallery, Boston Institute of Contemporary Art, and the San Francisco MoMA. Not bad. Lourdes, you've been the artistic director of Miami City Ballet for a little over 2 years. So what are some of your main goals for the company, and how does new work fit into that vision?
Well, I don't have a specific vision for Miami City Ballet, other than I want it to be a company where we perform great works, great dance works. And I want it to be a company where artists such as Shepard and Justin come and want to work with us and want to work with these dancers and want to work within the art form. And a company where the dancers are growing, they're evolving, they're happy, they're developing really as artists. So part of giving these dancers that experience involves commissioning work. And that's also the way that the art form, any art form, actually evolves. New work is vital. But I think the new work, it has to really, for me, come from a very organic and a very, really from a natural place where both the artists find a connection between themselves to create something, but also where the choreographer has established a connection with the company. And so one of the great things, one of the pleasures of really seeing Heatscape come to life with Miami City Ballet is our relationship with Justin grew very much like that. It was, there's an organization, it's an orchestral academy in Miami that's called the New World Symphony, which is headed by Michael Tilson Thomas. And one day they called me and they said, we'd love to do a project with our musicians and the dancers, and would you mind choreographing something for them? And I said, I'd love it, except there's a problem, I don't choreograph, but I know who does. So I called Justin, and it was a pretty unusual project. He had 9 days to put something together, but in the back of my mind was, I just want to get him down here. I just want him to see these dancers. I want these dancers to see him and see what happens, because once that relationship and that bond is created with them and the choreographer, then you're going to get a work of substance, a work that has some relevance to it. And that's exactly what happened. He came down, in 9 days, we gave you a lot of hours, I think, but, but it was still 9 days, he created a pas de deux, beautiful pas de deux, Chutes and Ladders. And that's when I then approached him. I said, would you come down to do a larger commission for us in 2014? And then what happened while in Miami, he was coming down to rehearse and to visit quite a bit. It's obviously a lot warmer in Miami than it is in New York during the winter. And he went to see Wynwood Walls. And I remember he came into the office and he was blown away by what he saw. And he said, you know, what about one of those artists for the new ballet, for the new commission? I went, bingo, that's what I want. And for me as an artistic director, I think because I don't choreograph, My creative outlet is really putting these artists together to see what happens, with any luck to evolve the art form. It's something that I've always been very passionate about.
So how did you first become exposed to Justin's work, and why did you think he'd be a good fit for the company?
I first came exposed in when I was with Morphosis. In the mail, I got an envelope with a DVD and a very short note written by Justin saying, I'd love for you to take a look at this work and give me your thoughts. And I was kind of, I was honored because I thought I had already heard a little bit about him. And I think it's something that you did, Justin, you said earlier for School American Ballet to Mendelssohn's.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it was for the New York Choreographic Institute.
And I was really taken by it because, first of all, it was so musical, and it's just my background. But also, he was so inventive. These are steps and a vocabulary and an idiom that we know and that we grew up around, and yet the way he was putting them together, I had never seen. And the other thing that really impressed me was how he was able to move large groups of dancers, which I think is a talent that choreographers don't always have and that you get after years and years of really honing your craft. So those three things made me think, and then I started hearing about him and, Increases and Year of the Rabbit and started things where he was doing for New York City Ballet. And that's really, we kind of stayed friends, and that's how it started.
So Justin, how did you feel when you heard from Lourdes about doing this first piece and having all these restrictions as far as time and size? And what was your thought process there?
I think initially I thought there were a lot of parameters in place for this part of it. Like it had to be very specific length and for a very specific arrangement of instruments, and cast size was specific too. But I think sometimes with those kinds of parameters, great things can amount from there. Also, I was really, at the time I was really drawn to the project because it was presented at the new Frank Gehry designed symphony space, which is a 360-degree vantage point. So it was just like a different way of presenting dance from the traditional proscenium. So I was just kind of excited by all these various things.
And so what were your first thoughts when you started to get to know the company? What struck you about them?
I was really impressed by the company. I think first off, they're a real community of human beings. So they have very distinct personalities, and they come together in a really sort of balanced way. And in terms of their dancing, I find them to be incredibly musical, which is very important to me when I'm creating new work. And they have tremendous work ethics, and I think they really value the creation process. They don't commission a whole lot of work, so when someone does come down there to work with them, they're very eager and focused, and so it makes for this ideal environment for a choreographer to come into.
Great. So let's take a look at our first excerpt of Heatscape. Justin,
sure.
Do you want to tell us what we're about to see?
Yeah, so this is in the first movement of the ballet, and I guess I should just say briefly that I chose to set this ballet to Martin New's first piano concerto, which is a pretty elaborate work and challenging work, but I think a work that's well suited to this company specifically. So it's a three movement piece, and this falls kind of in the middle of the first movement, and it's after a lot of group work, and there's this moment where the cast of 17 becomes sort of like chiseled away, and we're just left with these two dancers on stage. It's sort of a quiet moment. So we'll have them come out and take a look.
Justin, at New York City Ballet, where you're also a dancer, you're working with dancers who you see every day and you've known for a long time very intimately. So casting is probably a more intuitive process there. How do you approach casting in a company where you don't have that experience?
Well, I think, you know, the more experience with the company, the better. The more I can get to know the dancers, the better. And I think through the process of making the first pas de deux I created for Miami City Ballet, I got a chance to really get to know the company in a deeper way than going to any other company out there. But I think for me, it's I think the fact that I'm dancing still kind of works to my advantage. So a lot of times when I go to a company like Miami City Ballet, I'll take class with them and be a little bit more like incognito.
to it them. Doesn't happen, believe me. He thinks.
So like I'm just kind of in the back doing my own thing, and I kind of, you know, I'm able to watch the dancers in their element more so. So I was able to get to know the company pretty well, I think, before coming in to make this fuller piece for them.
So what are some of the qualities that you found in these dancers that you cast? And were you sort of listening to the music and finding qualities in the music that you then wanted reflected in the dancers? Or were you starting with the dancers and seeing qualities that appealed to you and then building around that?
Well, I think because I got to spend a lot of time working with them, I got to know them really well, not just as dancers, but also as human beings. And I got a real sense of their personalities and who these people are as individuals. And and so sort of through that process, I started to think about using this Martinu concerto for the company. And I just felt like it was a really good fit for the dancers here at this specific point in time. And so, my process was really just I started to listen to the music a lot and just see which dancers would emerge in my mind and kind of started to take shape in that way. And there was a lot of edits made, I think, through the process of developing the structure, and it became like this sort of like jigsaw puzzle to see like which dancers would fit where, and so it's kind of like a fun process for me.
When I was dancing, I always hoped to get cast by my personality.
It's so annoying, right?
So Lourdes, you know, new work obviously requires a lot of commitment from a company. You know, choreographers, you want specific dancers. In this case, Justin wanted 17 dancers, and they need a lot more time than, you know, people do staging something that already exists. How do you balance the needs of a new choreographer with the needs of the company for the rest of the season?
Well, obviously scheduling goes a long way, but the philosophy, at least at Miami City Ballet, is when there's a new work that's being commissioned, the choreographer gets the hours, the studios, and the dancers that they want. For several reasons. Number one is that you're going to end up getting a much better work the minute you're giving the artist what they need to develop it and not really putting parameters. I mean, we placed parameters for Chutes and Ladders, but that was a very different situation. So it's really, how many studios, how many dancers, and let's try to make this happen. And the other is that it's a very, you know, it's a gift. I view it as a gift that I can give or that the organization can give to the dancers. It's a really a personal thing that happens when you have a live choreographer who's actually creating on you and you're the instrument. It forces the dancer in a good way to grow, to really think about themselves. You have someone who's given you information that all of a sudden makes you think differently about your dancing and who you were, who you are, what you can be. So you want to nurture that, you want to support it, you want to give birth to it and allow it to happen. And that's just how I feel about it, and also how Miami City Ballet approaches it. One of the other things that we've learned there, at least that I've learned, is that we try to give the choreographer a large chunk of time. So we give them 3 full weeks where the dancers are at times rehearsing nothing else but Heatscape or nothing else but at this commission. And that's so that the real focus is on that work. And sometimes it's 4 weeks. And that's just a commitment that we make to the artist.
So let's watch another short excerpt. Justin, do you want to set us up?
Yeah. I think, is
it's
this?
Shimon.
Oh, it's Shimon. Okay. So this is Shimon Ito. He's a super athletic dancer. I'm a big fan of his. And it's just a short variation in the third movement. Comes in like a series of, well, it's actually a pas de trois. And so it's three variations in a row. And he kind of barrels out of the wings for this one. So we'll take a look. Just totally shot out of a cannon. I mean, it's so mean that I made him do that for sing-off.
So how long was the choreographic process for the ballet, and what stage do you feel like it's in right now?
Well, it's been a different process for me, I think, because I started the ballet in June, so the kind of intense rehearsal period happened then. We spent 3 weeks working on the material, and then I came back and I revisited it and continued to create new work in October, and then it doesn't premiere until the end of March. So I hope I still like it by then, but I think it's I'm used to coming into, you know, coming into the studio and working on something and you know, having it premiere in a couple months from there. But I'm actually really enjoying the time, kind of like the downtime in between things, where I can step away and actually not even think about the ballet, and then kind of turn it back on and start to figure out which aspects I really like, or which moments I want to change or tweak or alter. And so it's been this kind of like long-term process with these kind of meditative moments in between. So it's been cool.
So after for people who might not be familiar with how this works, after you've actually finished creating the ballet and everyone has their steps from start to finish, what do you work on after that?
Well, yeah, so it's, I think a lot of people maybe don't fully comprehend exactly what goes into the making of a ballet for a choreographer when they work with a ballet company. And what I mean by that is they almost take on this like director position. They're responsible to coordinate all these different moving parts. So once they finish creating the choreography, the content, the movement there, then their job isn't done. It's like, it's just phase one is over, and then the next phase is sort of like figuring out how to look at the piece on a larger scope and scale, and bringing in different artistic elements, whether it be, you know, the music, working with the orchestra, or working with a visual design element, which in this case was very much involved, and lighting and costumes and all that. So it's just about coordinating all those different moving parts and making sure everything comes together in a really cohesive way, or hoping for that at least.
And you're still polishing with the dancers, like, you know, movement quality and getting them to do. You're really, really specific in how you want moments to be performed. So you're still working on that as well, right?
Yeah. I think, you know, we just finished like the rough cut, I'll say. and then I'll return, you know, in a few weeks or so, and and we'll get back into the studio and continue to refine and work on it. Yeah.
So after the next excerpt, actually, Justin will stand up and coach a little bit, so you'll get to see a little bit what that process is like, even after the choreography is finished, how there's still a lot more work to do. So Justin, do you want to set up this next?
Yeah, next we have Trisha and Kleber, and this is in the second movement, and you know, like I was saying earlier, a lot of these dancers, their personalities are very much prevalent in the work, and so you'll notice like a distinction, I think, between the two pas de deux, and also musically it's very different, and we're lucky to actually have Francisco Reino here with us to play on piano, and yeah, we'll take a look and then we'll work on it a little bit.
Great. I don't even know if I have very much to say. That's pretty good. I think that this moment here, the développé front and then down there, we can draw that out much more and add more dynamic there. So to really elongate in this moment and then come back and fast weight change right afterwards to show. I think don't worry about being late either. I think if you go, you hold on to this, get a little bit late, and then catch up at the end, it'll make it more interesting. Play with the music. Cool. That was good. I think this first chassé turn we do here, if you think of it being more multi-dimensional instead of just projecting it towards the front here, especially since we're in this wonderful space and it has this kind of like circular nature to it, if we move into here and almost start back and then arc all the way around. And I think you can help with that too. By, how do you meet her there? Yeah, so here and then move into it, create more of a movement in your partnering there too. Yeah, a little more even. I think if I were Trisha and I chasseed this way, I would almost step there and come with me. Yeah, so I have to stay. Yeah, that's good. Almost pass, yeah. And then he reroutes you, I think. Yeah, that was the right idea, though. That was good. We'll work on that coordination. And then here, this moment here can be after the arabesque, and you come through more of a gesture and show more of a palm all, I think. Because we have this great moment where you're growing in the arabesque and then coming through and take your time there and long. Yeah, that's good. What comes right after that? Oh, you know what I was going to say? Can this part, later on when we get to here and you go into this there, it's the music, it's like, it's singing there. You know, it sounds like someone just like, so passionately singing. And I want to feel that more in the movement that you're doing. Instead of keeping it so technical, I think it should have more emotion to all these weight changes and maybe more seasick. I don't know. Can we try that with music? Do you have just right on? Do you know where we are? Yeah. Okay. I'll give you an end. And. Okay, good. Yeah, that's better. And remember this moment here to bring her arm back slightly. Do you feel like he's a little too far? You can tell me. I don't know if you can hear me. So yeah, a little bit further back. And then also, if you think to elongate the left leg and the left arm, so if we're here and we move into this, feel like there's two, it's like someone has your arm and someone has your leg and they're pulling them as far out as possible. So it's, you get to the most horizontal place before you step out from that moment. You know what I mean? Yeah, maybe less of a jump and more focus on the développé and then stepping back. Yeah. Yeah, that was better. Almost like a transfer of the weight through arabesque, but we're stepping out to there. Yeah, that's it. Good. The rest looked good to me. Thank you.
We have to save something for tomorrow night.
So let's switch gears and talk about the visual design element. And so, Justin, you just started working with sets for the first time last year with Everywhere We Go. Right. So maybe talk about a little bit more about your ideas for Heatscape and approaching Shepard?
Yeah. Well, so I started to spend a lot more time in Miami, and I started to explore the city a lot, and I started asking around, like, you know, where are the interesting neighborhoods? I wanted to go beyond South Beach and, you know, the beaches and the hotels and stuff and see what else was out there. And then I stumbled upon this neighborhood called Wynwood, which in the last several years has really transformed into this street art mecca. And I was so attracted to not only like the color of the visuals, but how sophisticated a lot of the art was there. And I started to think that all these murals would be amazing settings for movement. And that kind of led, you know, to more thought, and I took a few days to process it, and then I was like, well, what if we commissioned one of these artists to create something for this ballet? And I started to research all these artists and got really into it, and I found that I was really drawn to Shepard Fairey's work, and so I, you know, I think probably because I think his work really sits at the heart of the whole, at the whole neighborhood, and so I started to just look at a lot of his work, and I started to notice it a lot more in the community of Miami, not just in Wynwood, but there are all sorts of murals, kind of like where you least expect it. There's one major mural that's like right next to the ballet theater in Miami as well, and I think we'll take. Actually, I think it's the next. Is it the next slide? Oh, it's a Hope poster. The one after that. Yeah, this one here. And yeah, just I thought a lot of them were just visually stunning. And so at that point, I approached Lourdes, and we started a dialogue about the possibility of commissioning one of these artists, and she was super supportive and on board from the start. And so we kind of worked together, and through a mutual friend, I got in touch with Shepard just to kind of feel out if he'd be interested in working on something like this, because I don't think you had done anything for the theater or the ballet setting yet, and so it's kind of like uncharted territory in that sense. And you know, to my surprise, he was receptive and I think excited about it, I hope.
So actually the first two slides Definitely. That we had, Obey and the Hope poster, yeah. are two just very famous examples of Shepard's work. But Shepard, why don't you talk to us a little bit about what your primary influences are as an artist and how you get your inspiration?
Sure. Ballet wasn't one of them. But I grew up drawing, and I grew up in Charleston, South Carolina. It's pretty conservative there. And I enjoyed drawing and painting, but it wasn't until I got into skateboarding and punk rock about 30 years ago that that I really saw a connection between art and things that were very visceral. And you know, skateboarding and punk rock are very physical activities. So you know, my eventual connection to the ballet was, you know, even though they're very different cultures, the you know, the idea of connecting art to something that you know, that has a real emotional physicality to it. So I got into skateboarding and punk rock, which were opposed to, you know, any sort of mainstream activity and you know, the government and any, you know, the mainstream whatever. And I got into the idea of carving out your own creative voice within, you know, by any means necessary, do it yourself. I love that idea of self-empowerment. So I started to make homemade t-shirts and homemade stickers, but it was really when I went to the Rhode Island School of Design in 1988 and we were taking a trip to New York City to go to the Met. On the way in, going along 95 and the Cross Bronx Expressway and then the West Side Highway, seeing all these amazing graffiti pieces that were done by, you know, people who had code names, that I was energized by, you know, by this willingness to take risks. And they dropped everybody off at the Met, and I didn't go into the Met. I just walked around the city to look at the graffiti. And so this idea of art for everyone, that it was in public spaces where people lived and you didn't have to go to a gallery or a museum, I really liked that idea, because even though I'd spent much of my life learning how to draw and paint and being around people who appreciated art, I felt that it was a bit too narrow. So I became intrigued by propaganda posters from the Soviet Union and Cuba, and political art from Barbara Kruger and Robbie Canal. And it was really a synthesis of all those different things that ended up leading me in the direction that I took for my work. But the idea of doing work in public spaces, one, because I was too insecure to get approval from galleries, and two, because I wanted to have a direct, unmediated relationship with the public. Those were the two sides of the coin there.
So we have some slides of Wynwood Walls and other pieces in Miami that particularly inspired Justin and are great representations of your work. So maybe let's move on to the next slide, and you guys can sort of tell us a little bit about these and Shepard, what inspired you to create them, and Justin, what inspired you about them?
Well, this was the first mural of Shepard's that I saw, and it sits kind of right at the center of Wynwood, and so it kind of sparked the initial thought, I think, to bring Shepard on board, and I love the graphic nature of it and the use of color. I think it's a very specific color scheme, but very effective at the same time, and the various figures and points of inspiration, which I think Shepard can elaborate a little bit more on, was interesting to me as well.
So. Sure. This piece is in a sort of a compound enclave called the Wynwood Walls that has a large number of, I think, some of the most important street artists, graffiti artists, people who inspired me: Futura, Retina, Kenny Scharf, Maya Hayek, Swoon. A lot of amazing people, and a lot of what's on the walls is it's curated and it's changing over time. But I really I didn't necessarily deserve to, but I got one of the most prominent places in that area, and it was all facilitated by a guy named Tony Goldman, who is a real estate developer. He passed away a couple years ago, but that's him in the center of the piece. He's a real estate developer here, also in Philadelphia and in Miami, and a real supporter and advocate of the arts. His whole family is. And they do a project here that people might have seen. It's on the corner of Houston and Bowery. And right now it's under renovation, but back in the 80s, Keith Haring had a mural there. Kenny Scharf had a mural there. Kenny Scharf also has a mural there in the Wynwood Walls. But when Tony was a big supporter of my work, I got to do a mural at Houston and Bowery, and in a spot that I'd done illegally many times. So very ironic, I guess. If you can't beat them, join them, sort of situation. But I wanted to do this mural as a bit of a tribute to Tony and his family, and find some common ground. So in a sense, this is a collaborative piece, just like the Miami Ballet backdrop is a collaborative piece with Justin for Heatwave. But I talked to Janet, Tony's widow, and she said, I think you and Tony have a lot of heroes in terms of art, music, social theory, philosophy in common. So here's some of the people that Tony was really into that I know you dig as well. So I made this piece that was a synthesis of our sources of inspiration, as well as having a sort of pro-environment, pro-nature theme woven into it as well.
Great. Let's look at another one.
So this was another piece that I did near Wynwood in the design district in Miami. And I think that Justin had stumbled upon this piece as well. This is in progress. It's a mandala piece. And I love the concept of mandalas, the harmony, the concept of harmony and integration, but also they're as ornaments, they're really pleasing to create. And also from a technical standpoint, when I was first learning how to paint murals, the idea of how I was going to transfer an image to the wall. I made this like a pizza, where it's actually eight different slices repeated. And so I made a stencil of one slice, and then just figured if I did the math right, I'd get around to the other side, and it would all work out. This is another piece that Justin saw that I think he was somewhat inspired by in seeing its connection to the circular motion of the dancers and some of the choreography that he was interested in. Once we eventually started talking about the piece, my process of creating mandalas was something that we discussed, and it was really amazing that ended up in a way impacting part of the choreography. I feel very fortunate for that. Thank you. But anyway, that was another piece in Miami, and I think there's the next slide. It's just a process shot
one.
Of that.
Yeah.
Cool.
So there it is. It's very a rough wall, but it ended up looking smooth in the end. So.
Yeah, I remember seeing this. It was actually just like a pizza joint across the street, and I was getting pizza one day, and I looked up, and there's this tremendous mural above me. And I just remember thinking that it looked like some sort of odd blueprint for a choreographic movement. And I was like, what if we take this concept, which is based on creating from the center outwards in a very kind of like detailed, meticulous fashion, and what if we applied that to choreography, like what would come of that? And so what happened was we developed these sort of like mandala-inspired choreographic structural patterns and movements. And I wish we had the cast of 17 with us, because it involves so many of the dancers, and we could show you, and it would fit so well in this circular space. But you'll just have to buy a ticket to come to Miami instead.
And so let's look at what else we have.
So this is actually the previous iteration of the Wynwood Walls piece that you saw the Tony Goldman portrait of. So this was originally done in 2009 when they were first developing this complex, and it was all done with a different technique. The one with Tony Goldman is all painted. This was all done with wheat pasting different pieces of wallpaper that I had printed and painted in my studio. And I developed that technique from years of needing to try to take over large spaces in cities, but without permission, and doing it before the police arrived. In some regards, my concerns about efficiency ended up impacting my aesthetic, which now become a choice rather than a necessity. But I think that the always the challenges of how you can deal with the constraints of a situation sometimes make you do your best work. So I think that a cool analogy with this mural to the dance piece is, that there's, there are all these pieces, and you have to decide how they're going to come together. And I'm using a lot of motifs that have the ability to be repeated, but then it's not always a perfect pattern. So there's disruption there. But I think Justin had also seen this online, and you liked some of the specific elements that he liked within this piece that ended up being part of our process of coming to the backdrop.
So yeah, let's look at the next slide.
Shepard, how do you stop your work from being vandalized? I mean, you did it.
Yeah. Well, and that's why I can't complain about it without being a hypocrite. I can't stop it from being vandalized. And one of the things that is I think important to your survival as a street artist is not being too precious. And it's ironic because as a creator, the idea of making something that you're proud of is essential. But for me, making the piece, being proud of the end result, basking in it for about 30 seconds, and then moving on is really important. And anything that's ephemeral, these dance pieces, of course, you can you can videotape it, but really that, you know, that moment of experiencing it firsthand, there's nothing that can really replicate that experience. So for me, like making the piece, finishing it, interacting with some of the people who saw the process, that's really visceral. It's really exciting. But then it's time to do the next thing. And of course, if I can, if something gets tagged, I'll go and I'll try to touch it up, because a lot of times, you know, I like to say haters never prosper. But I will go back. But really, when it comes down to my true philosophy, I'm even if I think their energy is misplaced, I'm more of an advocate for the rebel with a can of black spray paint than I am for, Bank of America.
So now we're actually looking at an early iteration of the backdrop that you two created together. So do you want to sort of talk us through the development of the backdrop?
Yeah, I think we started to talk about a lot of reoccurring symbols in Shepard's work that existed kind of in dance and in ballet, and one of them we see here is this bird symbol, and of course there's a constant reoccurring presence of the bird as a symbol in classical ballet, and we have this female figure in ballet kind of at least through George Balanchine's philosophy has been thought of as being a feminine art form and very much like empowering to the female form, and you know, various others. I think we talked about like lotus flower images and how they're amazingly beautiful symmetrical pieces in nature, but at the same time they're these living, breathing, and fleeting organisms that, in the same way as a ballet, don't last. So they're there for a moment and then they're gone. And so we tried to look into the meaning behind a few of these symbols and try to incorporate them into at least kind of like let them inform what the backdrop would become. And we went through a few phases of that, and this was kind of one of the initial drops we developed together. And also, one thing I find really beautiful about Shepard's work, and you can see it in this mural, is the kind of textural aspect of it. If you look a little bit more closely, you'll notice that there's quite a bit put into the detailing and you know, a lot of meticulous work that went into the design of this, and so yeah, this was phase one.
So let's look at the next slide.
Yeah, so this is just another iteration. Justin had liked the lotus element and some of the other, the rays, some of the other pieces. So he'd also seen a mural that I did in Dumbo in Brooklyn that I did on top of a brick wall, and I loved the character of the brick. It was aged brick. It's something that you feel like it's had a life and there's stories to tell from the surface itself. So I just painted a one color mural on top of that with a little bit of varnish over the brick, so that the history of the brick still was an integral part of the piece. So replicating that in what I was trying to create for Justin was important. But I liked these pieces, but as Justin fine-tuned the choreography and thought about what the needs were for the piece and what I'd done, he had adapted his vision, he evolved his vision, and I was perfectly happy with that, because I really felt like watching some of his pieces, video of some of his old pieces, the gestures of the dancers, the silhouettes of the dancers, there's art in that, and the idea, and that's the most essential art, really. So the idea of anything that I would do competing with that was something that I really felt would be an injustice. So, I that's the great thing about collaboration. We could bounce ideas, and I I enjoy that because with my work, I like to leave no stone unturned. I like to experiment a lot, and anything that I discover, even if it doesn't work for Justin, I'll recycle it later.
So let's look at another slide. I think that you can see some of that development there. Can you talk about maybe the change on the bottom?
Yeah, so this was the first phase as well, and you know, I knew that Justin liked the dove, so, and some of the pattern work. So this was my idea that I would make the image less contrasty at the bottom to not compete with the dancers as much. But you know, quickly after round one, Justin started to zoom in on what he thought would work, and so we abandoned this. But this is one of the other ideas.
I think like also over time, you know, through the process of developing the choreography, like the original intent for what was needed visually also changed, and so there came a point in the process where we had to kind of like go back and say like, look, this piece turned into something different than what I originally envisioned, and like, let's see how we can adapt the visuals to really like best enhance the experience, I think, so.
So let's look at another slide.
Yeah, that was another one that was inspired by a mural that I had done in Los Angeles that used this, what I call the peace elephant. But once again, same thing. Justin liked this image, and it was one of the things he had mentioned as appealing to him. But he had really refined his vision. And you know, for me, I make a lot of work, and throwing things out there, I'm not too precious about it. I think that the reputation of artists as prima donnas, I'm really trying to counter that. I get to draw and paint all day. I mean, I'm so lucky. So the idea of giving Justin a few more things to pull from, especially when it's from the body of work that I've built over the years, and he's drawing his inspiration from things that I've already put on walls. It's a very easy process to give him more options and keep evolving what we're trying to do.
So let's look at the next one.
So this is the final version that we honed in on. I think it's also just important for me to iterate that, you know, there's not necessarily like a specific like narrative that this drop or this ballet insinuates, but that it's more about the piece being this this symbiotic meeting point between all these various artistic mediums, and just like creating a cohesive experience for viewers to tickle their senses. So whether it be visual or movement or music, and so I think like the way that this whole process developed was, I started to organically take on these influences early on, and then I brought Shepard on to work on this, and it's kind of like throwing everything into a pot and like adding heat and see what comes out of it. And there's a lot of different influences in this work specifically, but I think we achieved the proper balance with this final version in regards to how we broke up the drop specifically, and how it relates to the movement, and how it kind of like frames the dancers, and I can't wait to see it live, yeah, soon.
So, Justin, having talked to you a lot over the years, and I know you pretty well by now, I know you're always looking to challenge yourself. You approach each new work as an opportunity to expand rather than maybe repeat what's worked for you in the past. So what are some ways that you are challenging yourself with this ballet, with pushing some ideas maybe a little further than you have before?
Well, I've always been interested in working with groups and kind of breaking up the traditional hierarchy of ballet, And I think this piece takes it even one step further by kind of empowering the individual, but I think it's about bringing together 17 very much distinct individuals into one collective space. So it's a slight alteration in my process, and also the music is just was sort of a mountain to tackle. It seemed like I was really excited about it from the get-go, and through the process of developing the work, it really challenged me in so many ways. I think rhythmically, it's really tough, and but I think in the end, it's going to be really rewarding. And the dancers, like I said earlier, they're super musical, and they're capable of moving to it. So
you'll see in this next excerpt, you can get a better sense of what Justin's talking about, even though we don't have the whole group, about how sometimes dancers break away and they're in the spotlight and then they sort of join the group again and they become the core or the backdrop for someone else who's broken away and taken in the spotlight, which is different from sort of how traditional classical structure works, where someone who's in the center is always in the center, someone who's on the side is always on the side. Mm. And there was another aspect of this excerpt that you mentioned that was interesting about how the dancers sort of rush the stage.
Yeah, so I think I was, typically when you look at traditional ballet, you have the dancers on stage and they sort of present towards the front and they move forward, and it's a pretty typical way of presenting dance. But I think with this specific ballet, I was interested in kind of like turning that concept upside down. And so what we have is we immediately set the dancers at the very front lip of the stage, and then we worked on developing how the dancers can create certain structural movements moving from the front backwards. So it was just like an interesting challenge that was kind of like that we just kind of put on ourselves and to see what would result. And and also I was interested in finding a way to kind of like connect the visual element to the audio element, that being the orchestra, right off the bat. And so we have this kind of like visceral rush from the dancers that move from the upstage point to the downstage point in an instance, and it kind of creates this electricity that links those two sides, and so I was excited about that. And we're gonna see kind of like an abridged version, like a five-person version, but it's actually, when the ballet is actually performed, it's actually 17 dancers, so keep that in mind when you're watching.
Thank you.
So Shepard, what has been the biggest takeaway for you from this process? Have your ideas about ballet changed at all?
Yes.
Good answer.
The you know, I actually was exposed to a good amount of ballet because I would always do summer programs for art, visual art and performing art at the Brevard Art College, North Carolina School of the Arts, RISD. There was a lot of dance happening there. I went to a boarding school called the Otto Wild School of Music and the Arts, and I actually participated in some pas de deux because I had a crush on the girl that I was partnering with. But I was not nearly flexible enough to really pull it off. But you know what I think, like any art form, you know what goes into it, the amazing discipline, practice, rigor. It's incredibly inspiring to see the dedication that the people have, and you know, and it reminds me to you know, to always, no matter what I achieve, to push my craft and you know, put the time in, which I think I do. But it's, you know, you can never get too comfortable because there's always somebody younger, fitter, more talented that's going to come along. So I love seeing the end result of that kind of discipline. And the connection I see between a lot of my more recent work that's sort of focused on peace and harmony and a more feminine side of things, because I'm married and I have two daughters, so I'm surrounded by it. But the you know, the beauty of the sort of feminine side of things, the family unit, that you know, I think that the movement in dance, the form, all of the different shapes that you see, it all is something that's, you know, it's beautiful, but it takes a lot of practice. The idea of the difficulty of something that looks effortless in a way. And I think Justin, one of the things I like about Justin though is that he's taking what I think is from the history of ballet, things that are proven to be aesthetically appealing, but he's also tweaking them a bit in challenging ways. That's what I strive for in art. I look at, and I've been accused of it all the time, of taking inspiration from historical art forms, and I'm very guilty of it, but I'm always filtering it through my sensibility. Seeing Justin do that is in his, you know, in his art form is very inspiring to me. So, you know, this idea of, you know, striving for the best, and then the ability to cross-pollinate different art forms that I can share my work with a ballet audience, and that a ballet audience, you know, might be turned on to this other art form, and the street artist might be turned on to ballet. You know, this is all exciting to me. So, those are the takeaways.
So, Lourdes, what's been most exciting for you seeing this come together? What do you think it's bringing to your dancers and your audience?
I think what it's bringing actually to the art form is it proves to me once again that dance is powerful enough to absorb all these other art forms. That it can, it, you know, we can take it in and produce something. I think in terms of the dancers, what's wonderful to see is what we spoke about earlier, that having a live choreographer choreograph on you forces the artist, forces them to evolve, and then they take that growth into their other rep. They take that growth into other works that they've done. And then what happens to me as an artistic director is I have a very different dancer in front of me that I all of a sudden see in a different light, that's dancing a different way, that I can move in a different manner that was not available to me because they've been exposed to this. So anything, my philosophy is that anything that I can do to get a better dancer, a better work, a better company, a better performance, which is going to relate to all of you guys, I'm all for it, and clearly they're doing that.
Before we sign off with our final excerpt, if you're enjoying this and interested in the process of dance making and collaboration, you might have seen on your seats you had a postcard for a film called Ballet 422. It actually is a verite documentary, feature length, that shows a lot of the things that we've been talking about today. Through just a fly-on-the-wall verite style, showing Justin working on his third ballet at New York City Ballet. And that is opening at Film Society of Lincoln Center and Sunshine Cinema on February 6th, and in Miami on February 20th. And Heatscape has its first performance on March 27th, in West Palm Beach, yes. And then moves to Miami in April. So you're really just seeing the tip of the iceberg. Obviously, you're only seeing five dancers. This is a huge cast with a lot of complexity, and they're all amazing. So if you're going to be in Miami, or if you have friends in Miami, don't let them miss it. So before we see our final excerpt, I just want to thank Mary Sharp Cronson and her amazing staff at Works in Process. I'd also like to thank our pianist, our dancers, our panelists, and you for coming out. Enjoy and tell your friends about this.